and crowbars just because some houses have security systems. They just find a house that isn't protected. In fact, 83% of burglars admitted they look to see if there's an alarm. But only 1 in 5 homes has home security. Maybe because most companies don't make it easy. It's a hassle to shop around, schedule an installer, and often it's just expensive. That's why SimpliSafe is my top choice. They make it easy. There's no contract, hidden fees, or fine print. Prices are always fair and honest. Around-the-clock monitoring of every door, window, and room is just $15 a month. But SimpliSafe's video verification technology is the real standout. When an alarm is triggered, SimpliSafe visually confirms that a break-in is happening, allowing police to get to the scene 3.5 times faster than other home security companies. Right now, SimpliSafe is offering a huge deal. Go to simplisafe.com/MME and get free shipping and a money-back guarantee. That's simplisafe.com/MME today. simplisafe.com/MME. The Mysterious Mr. Epstein is sponsored by Best Fiends. Nature is vicious. Step outside, peer into the blades of grass, and right there beneath your feet is a world teeming with struggle and strife. Bugs in a constant battle with each other for supremacy and the crumbs of your sandwich. But it's in balance. That's not the case for the bugs living in the fanciful land of Minutia, where after a mysterious meteor smashed into Mount Boom, a strange force transformed the slugs who lived there into an army of greedy pests. What am I talking about? I'm talking about the story from Best Fiends, a fun, casual, puzzle-based game that puts you on the side of the nice bugs, fighting the scourge of the slugs. It's easy to play and easy to get drawn in. I'm on level 38, and it's not just a way to kill time. The puzzles are challenging, requiring you to collect characters, using them strategically, and updates provide new levels and events every month. If you need a new distraction or infatuation, find out why Best Fiends has 100 million downloads globally. Engage your brain with fun puzzles and collect tons of cute characters. Best Fiends is a 5-star rated mobile puzzle game available to download free on the Apple App Store or Google Play. That's friends without the R, Best Fiends. If you're enjoying The Mysterious Mr. Epstein but want to hear more about this criminal case, there's another podcast from Wondery called Real Crime Profile that we know you'll enjoy. In Real Crime Profile, Jim Clemente, retired FBI supervisory special agent, Laura Richards, a criminal behavioral analyst, and Lisa Zambetti, the casting director for CBS's Criminal Minds, team up together to profile behavior from real criminal cases. Right now, Real Crime Profile is doing a special companion series to The Mysterious Mr. Epstein called Forensically Deconstructing Epstein. Subscribe to Real Crime Profile on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or wherever you're listening right now. It's the late 1980s, and Jeffrey Epstein is flying first class from New York to Palm Beach. Sitting beside him is a man named Robert Meister. Epstein's been known to use bogus upgrade stickers to get a seat at the front of the plane, but Meister is a man who belongs in first class. He's the vice chairman of a large insurance company called Aon. One of his biggest clients, and a man he considers his friend, is Leslie Wexner, the billionaire founder of a company called The Limited. Sitting next to him, something about Epstein catches Meister's attention. They talk the entire flight. He's an interesting, charming guy, Meister thinks. He files Epstein's name away in his mental Rolodex. Sometime later, according to one author's account, Wexner confides in Meister that he's having problems with the people managing his money. And Meister recalls that engaging man he met on the plane. He offers to introduce Wexner to Epstein, which he does. Soon, Epstein and Wexner are working together. And here's another place where the facts seem to shift. Epstein reportedly brags to friends that he first met Wexner back in 1986 and won his trust by convincing him to keep his money out of stocks just before the 87 market crash. But if that story is true, it means that Epstein was already managing Wexner's billions at the same time he was running a Ponzi scheme with Hoffenberg. When a reporter for Vanity Fair points this out, Epstein insists that it wasn't until 89, well after the crash, that he started working with Wexner. Either way, Jeffrey Epstein is about to become very, very rich. Leslie Wexner is in his early 50s. He's sharply dressed, with a trim build and a winning smile that somehow says, "Can you believe I'm a billionaire? What luck?" That's the public persona anyway. At least one of his friends says Wexner is a lonely man. isolated by his success and vulnerable. But even a lonely billionaire running a huge company will have layers of staff, advisors, and lieutenants. What's unusual about Epstein as he enters Wexner's life is how quickly he penetrates Wexner's inner circle. Soon, it seems Epstein's the only one in that circle, patrolling the long halls at L. Brand's HQ, visiting Wexner's Ohio mansion, overseeing construction of Wexner's 100 million black-hulled triple-decker superyacht. He torments Wexner's employees and aggravates the billionaire's friends. Bob Fitrakis, a political science professor and former journalist who wrote for an alt-weekly newspaper in Ohio, remembers what people were saying at the time.
Every time Wexner's name was mentioned, Jeff Epstein's name was mentioned as his sort of fixer, or logistic guy, or financial man. And everyone knew that Jeff Epstein spoke for Les Wexner, that he was empowered. Now, is he a glorified valet? Is he a fixer? Is he a forcer? Is he a lover? I mean, how suddenly is he in charge of, you know, all Wexner's finances and dealings?
Epstein becomes more and more involved in aspects of Wexner's life. He goes from overseeing the building of Wexner's yacht and dealings with friends and family to even replacing Wexner's own mother on the board of his charitable foundation. Then, on July 30th, 1991, Wexner hands Epstein the keys to his multi-billion dollar empire. He signs a power of attorney agreement that grants Epstein the right to act on Wexner's behalf. Stock purchases, real estate transactions, loans, all without Wexner's oversight. Around this same time, Epstein helps Wexner develop a vast community of luxury homes outside Columbus, Ohio. Epstein gets one of these homes at a steep discount. It has 23 rooms, a pool, and a bathhouse. But Epstein's true real estate prize is in Manhattan. Wexner owns a property there that makes even the New York apartments of Epstein's former Bear Stearns colleagues look like dollhouses. Wexner's townhouse is a few blocks from the Met. It's 7 stories tall and 21,000 square feet with a 15-foot-high oak door. It's one of the largest private residences in all of Manhattan. But Wexner barely even spends time there. So Epstein moves in 1996. He tells people that he bought the house from Wexner, but there's no public document recording the sale. Epstein will use this mansion to entertain the likes of Bill Clinton, Prince Andrew, the Duke of York, the Crown Prince of Saudi Arabia, and a young woman who works at this mansion will become one of the first known victims of Epstein's sexual assaults. That's on the next episode of The Mysterious Mr. Epstein. This has been part 2 of 6 of The Mysterious Mr. Epstein. On the next episode, the kid from Coney Island buys his very own island and uses his newfound connection to Victoria's Secret to horrifying ends. If you like stories of far-reaching scandals, listen and subscribe to my series, American Scandal, where we tell the stories from the Enron financial fiasco to the Elliot Spitzer political drama. You can find it by searching for American Scandal in your favorite podcast app. This is a story about power, abuse, and manipulation. If you'd like to help us spread the word, please give us a 5-star review and tell your friends to subscribe. We're available on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, CastBox, and every major listening app, as well as Wondery.com. If you're listening on a smartphone, tap or swipe over the cover art of this podcast. You'll find the episode notes, including some details you may have missed. You'll also find some offers from our sponsors. By supporting them, you help us offer this show to you for free. This series deals with issues of sexual violence. If you or someone you know is a victim of sexual assault, reach out for help. In the U.S., you can contact the National Sexual Assault Hotline by calling 1-800-656-HOPE. That's 1-800-656-4673. Or you can chat anonymously with a hotline staffer by messaging the Rape, Abuse, and Incest National Network at online.rainn.org. The Mysterious Mr. Epstein is hosted, edited, and executive produced by me, Lindsey Graham, for Airship. Sound designed by Derek Behrens. This episode is written by Michael Canyon Meyer. Additional reporting and research by Alyssa Jung Perry and Heather Schreringer. Associate producer is Caleb Bissinger. Executive producers are Jenny Lauer-Beckman, George Lavender, Marshall Louie, and Hernan Lopez for Wondery.